check the straw poll one more time, but it looked like, yeah, it looks like Modern is pretty much crushing it. Opponent mulled to 4. And it's Tron, and I'm probably losing to the mull to 4. We'll see though. Ooh, an Assassin's Trophy. That gives me a chance. I am going to be battling at Grand Prix Las Vegas next weekend. So I think I'm going to draw step, go after the power plant. Then we go destroy, discard. Is there any method I use for deciding which land to destroy? In that case, it was like pretty close to random. The only information that I had is that my opponent played the mine first, and given the London Mulligan rule, it was very, very unlikely that my opponent started with two copies of either, but it is possible that they played the mine and then drew a second copy of the mine. So I think it's like, you know, 0.25% better to kill the power plant there, but pretty close to random. Oh man, this would have been a seasoned pyromancer if I hadn't just made that last minute change. Why, can you guys explain why you're saying don't kill the tower? Maybe I'm a rookie, but that'll require some explanation for me. Okay, because it's convenient for them to play the tower as their third thing, like, you know, tap 2, Sylvan Scrying, play tower, and have 3 mana. That makes sense. That's a great point. So opponent has assembled Tron, and I can't do anything about it. I can attack for 8. Feels like Well, I guess I want to. Probably start with spell bomb. All right, that's something. So, I guess I want to put myself in a position where I can beat Wormcoil Engine, though definitely the biggest concern is going to be Ugin. So, if I can beat Wormcoil Engine with what I have on the battlefield, so I think I probably just play my land and don't play anything more to the board because then. If my opponent plays Ugin, I lose the least amount to the minus. And if my opponent plays Wurmcoil, then I can go Liliana, Edict You, Maelstrom Pulse the tokens. And so I think I can beat any single card from this position. Maybe like land Ulamog is bad, but even then I have Liliana. So I think my plan is just attack and not add anything else to the board. And then that puts me in the best position against Oblivion Stone and Ugin, and I should be fine against Wurmcoil Engine as long as it's not Wurmcoil Engine plus something else. Yep, Pulse kills both Worm tokens because they're both just named Worm. Yep. It's not exactly what I was hoping to see. Wondering if I'm supposed to Liliana plus here. I don't think I can. Maybe I can. No, this is fine. I'll stick with the plan. Yeah, Mango Gang nailed it. That's what my plan is. Also hoping my play involves some number of lightning bolts and Bloodbraid Elves at this point. All right. Going face, right? No, I actually think I'm supposed to leave the wooded foothills uncracked because I don't want my opponent to be able to cut me off of green mana. And GG. Lucky boy, indeed. So I'd say these are my weakest cards. Yeah, I'd probably lose that game if my Assassin's Trophy was Abrupt Decay instead. All right, so it's going to be one of these classic games where it's basically just Tron against Liliana, and usually the Tron player wins, but not always. What's up, Kanye? Good job winning Fandom Legends last week. I'm going to try to give you a good run for your money this time. Yo, Jarvis. I figure I can lose the ravine here because if I draw land, then I can Bloodbraid, and if I don't draw land, I can go Ren and six, pick up ravine. Okay, so we want to do Edict and then Bloodbraid. And I think I can afford. Maybe Mountain is best here, actually. Reasonable. That's pretty good. So a wide variety of things that I could do with it. But we're definitely starting here. And I think I need to get more value than just getting my opponent's draw step. If I was a bit ahead in this game, I would draw step the Kolaghan's Command. But as it stands, I'm probably going to need to destroy the Worm Coil and pick up my Blood Breed. All right, opponent not making it easy on me. Sure, so I think I just use both my planeswalkers and then Cascade. We're hanging in there, ladies and gentlemen. This has been quite the slugfest. All right, well, it was fun when it lasted. Wonder if I'm supposed to go to one and kill the worm token. What are my outs here? Well, I don't think my outs involve going to one, so let's kill Lifelinker. Think I need to draw exactly Lightning Bolt or else I lose. So the move is going to be pick up Verdant Catacombs, sack it for a swamp, sack this, draw Lightning Bolt. Oh, I still die anyway. Excuse me, chat. It was not runner, runner, lightning bolts in game number one. It was like I had 6 or 7 turns to piece together two between lightning bolt and Bloodbraid Elf. Well, it's the type of hand you usually lose with. But my deck's bad against Tron. Like, I don't have Dark Confidant. I don't have any extra sideboard cards, so there's not as much that I can mulligan towards, but I think I need to do better than this. And now this one I'm probably supposed to keep on six. Like, just throw back... Well, I guess throw back Mountain, and then I can use the Wren to help. So basically, I think I have a good chance to win this game if I find Fulminator Mage quickly. And probably not winning if I don't. Okay. There is a chance. I think I'll just go for the mine this time. Pretty good. I feel like I'm definitely discarding Ooze. Probably just Ooze and Liliana. I think the plan is clearly racing here and not resource denial. So I'm valuing getting that extra elemental there. Okay. So my opponent has Ugin potential next turn. I can hit for 8 with the Ravine, but I think Bloodbraid seems good because it does give me the chance to hit, Thoughtseize or Fulminator Mage. And then the Ravine can finish off the Ugin in the worst case scenario. So, am I starting with Inquisition then? I think so. Okay, so there's Ugin. Ugin Wormcoil, Oblivion Stone Ballista. think I'm supposed to take Oblivion Stone. And then if I hit exactly Thoughtseize, then I can take Ugin. Okay, so I'm putting my opponent down to 9 this turn. Then let's say the Ugin comes down, wipes everything. Alright, so I can either just kill Ugin with the Ravine, or I can go Pulse Goyf. I think I just kill it with the Ravine. Wow, do you really not have a land drop to make? You have all spells. It's intimidating. Wow, somehow I'm down to 5 minutes on my clock. I guess this was a heated match. Yep, blast zone. Big ballista. Opponent's definitely showing strength there, blocking with the ballista. It probably means they have another something good in hand. All right, do your worst. I wonder if they just made an error in blocking with the ballista. I don't think that was a bit ambitious. Alright, brick on this draw step and Ravine is lethal. No Karn, no Ulamog. Oh geez, terrifying. Worm Coil. So the game continues. Steams, I appreciate the sub. Definitely attacking with the Goyf just to force the blast zone. Right. Well, I tried, chat. I think I fought hard. ChannelFireball.com features the best game, best players in the game, writing about the best game in the world. You can find strategy content from dozens of different players about every different format. I've had a couple of articles come out on Channel Fireball this week about Standard, about Modern. I got one about Legacy coming down the pike. You can find my stuff there. Fandom just released the list, so can I find those on Goldfish? The Modern Horizon cards do not make this matchup better. No, there is nothing really printed in modern. Oh, unless you have collector oof. If you had a couple collector oofs in your sideboard, it would improve the Jund matchup. Interesting. We have a scape shift deck, maybe. Bring to light scape shift. I did play Alpine Moon in my sideboard at Mythic Championship London, so that was 2 Mythic Championships ago. I played Alpine Moon in my sideboard, and Tron was like 12% of the field at that event. So yeah, it's that seemed fine. So I couldn't see any way to kill Saheeli that turn because, of course it's tempting to clear out the blocker. That would make the Goyf a 3-4. I don't have any other types in my hand to discard if I even if I wanted to target myself with the discard. And then I know my opponent has Knight of Autumn as a discard that won't grow the Goyf. So I'm just gonna pass with the Kolaghan's command available. I think I'm dead if my opponent goes for the combo, but they might not go for the combo into open mana. And yeah, I don't know if there's a way to slip in the lightning bolt at any point. Now, good old Bloodbraid comes down. Should have 5 power to kill the Saheeli. I think it's totally reasonable to play 4 Renin 6. I've chosen to play 3, but I think it's good enough card that you could easily play 4. You can find my deck list by clicking on Stream Decker Current Deck List on the right side of your screen. Oh, just a quick correction from what I was saying earlier. Of course, Lightning Bolt does break up the combo because you can just kill the Saheeli when the Felidar Guardian is targeting it. There's nothing obvious that I want to sideboard out in this matchup. Maybe like the fourth Lily, the fourth Goyf. Here, I'm going to post in the chat the deck lists for the Fandom Legends tournament for anyone who wants to browse them. Hopefully, I'll carve out a few minutes before the event starts and we can sort of go over those together. We have 4 Vampires. It's about what I expected. 3 Scapeshift. Mono Red. Jund Dinos. 2 Jeskai. 3 Esper, 1 Band. Yeah, pretty much like a, you know, predictable field. Nice cross-section of the format. Yeah, this is like a really bad hand. I almost want to go to 5. I think I'm going to 5. Like, Assassin's Trophy is my only turn 2 play. It's just my worst nightmare. Well, this game's probably not going well. I'm just gonna kill that. I don't really know what kind of like convoke or instant speed blink type stuff my opponent could have, so. Wow, both players stuck on lands. I definitely have it worse than opponent. Sure. Haha, now the truth comes out. There's no snow mana. Wow, that was a miss with Oath of Nyssa. That is amazing. That's like, we're talking like 1% of the time that happens. I mean, obviously, depending on your configuration, but. So now after seeing the rest in peace, these, well, I guess these 9 cards all get worse. I think I'm going to stick with the Wrens. They seem good enough. Could bring in Fulminator. Fourth Lily is coming back for sure. Go for the Miser's Fulminator Mage. Well, Terror says Logan wouldn't get stuck on one land. I'll tell you what wouldn't have happened to Logan is he would not mull to 6 and have Assassin's Trophy as his only turn 2 play because he doesn't like that card. And I think if I had basically any other card in that spot where I had Assassin's Trophy, I would have been able to keep my 6 card. So, it does matter. These small decisions do matter when you play Jund. Do I think Merfolk's a competitive deck in Modern? I say yes. It's probably not in the top 10 decks in Modern, but I think it's, I would definitely categorize it as competitive. I wouldn't be surprised to see it in the top 8 of a Modern Grand Prix. Yeah, Spirits is a good deck too. I think one of the teams brought Spirits for the Team Modern Super League on Tuesday. Speaking of which, my team, along with Logan Nettles and Gabriel Nassif Yellow Hat, were playing the top four of the Team Modern Super League on Tuesday. That's going to be a great spectacle to watch. Taking on the Brad Nelson team. I think I can just let that hit me for now. I don't have a lot of non-land cards to work with, so I have to make them count. Ethel asks, what was my reason for running Innocent Blood over Diabolic Edict in Legacy Pox? So this is a throwback to a deck from many, many years ago, but the simple answer to your question is just that it's one mana versus two, which is a very, very big deal in Legacy. You have got me there, my friend. All right, this game is still winnable. Especially Bloodbraid was a pretty good draw there. Oh, something terrible happened, chat. I left up Bloodstained Mire with this Lightning Bolt, but I have no fetchable red lands left in my deck. So that means that if my opponent plays the Felidar Guardian and targets the Icefang Quaddle, I may have to fatal push the 1/1, and then things are annoying from there. But I guess more likely they'll just target the Oath of Nissa, right? This is a close game. I'm going to have to both play tight and draw well if I'm going to have a chance. So I trophy the Baloth, put them to the test if they want to keep or shuffle away the card that they scryed. They shuffle it away. So that's at least some bit of good news. Then think I do nothing, just take the two. Okay, this would be a good turn for you to draw a land. It worked. Alright, so it's Bloodbraid Elf against nothing, but my opponent gets the first draw step, and I have a very low life total. And their deck is chock full of very, very good top decks. Sure. This is tight. So now note that I can fatal push the Knight of Autumn by cracking my Verdant Catacombs, but my opponent's deck does have Lightning Bolt, so I want to be very careful with that. And the reason I'm okay with this plan is that I still have lethal next turn with a Goyf attack plus a Lightning Bolt. Now, the card that I did not play around here is Rest in Peace. That would be pretty annoying if my opponent finds Rest in Peace. Wow, Teferi Time Raveler. Sure. So I can lose here if my opponent finds like Felidar into Blink something into Saheeli. But I think it's right to, it's actually pretty tough whether I hold the bolt or just hit the Teferi. Maybe I should just hit the Teferi. It's like really tempting to just want to kill my opponent next turn, but I think given that I have the Fatal Push also, I should maybe just make sure nothing bad happens. Gonna name Beast. Felidar Guardian is a cat beast. And I don't know what other beasts they might have, but there's probably more beasts than cats. Yeah, I could have considered playing the Engineer pre-combat named Ice Fang Quaddle. Baloth is a beast. Well spotted. Right, we've played a couple of crazy matches so far today. 1-1. Lost to Tron, beat four color Felidar. Zero Gruel asks, when was Cloud Post banned in Modern? So the very first Modern event was Pro Tour Philadelphia, and Cloud Post was legal, and it was kind of like the deck to beat, just like Cloud Post, Primeval Titan, cast Emrakul on turn four type stuff. And then after that event, they did like a huge swath of bannings, and Cloud Post was one of them. I guess that's a grudging keep. At least I have the peat lands that I can cycle later on. This is an interesting matchup if it's Urza. If I was going to play no ban list modern and I was just trying to have fun, like not necessarily be as competitive as possible, I'm sure I would play Elf combo with Glimpse and Green Sun Zenith, Deathrite Shaman. Sounds sweet. Interesting. Detention Sphere is not what I expected to see. I am playing Golgari in the Fandom Legends tournament. Fandom is in 40 minutes, 39 minutes. Ooh, what's my first opponent's Marcio Carvalho, and he's playing Jeskai Super Friends. And I'm playing Golgari. Have some fun with that. I did not bring Elder Spell. That was like my 76th or 77th card that I ended up cutting at the last minute. Why would my opponent not play that? Because they're going to Whir of Invention for something? They're going to Whir for a Spyglass or something like that? So Jeff's got a question about M20 draft. Sephara, I think that's the angel where you can tap four flyers to put it into play for free. Should I play three Fairy Miscreant, three with three other flyers, or should I play a third Moorland Inquisitor, Frilled Sea Serpent, and Anticipate? Well, I definitely think you should play Anticipate. So I'm inclined to just go for the we'll call it the good cards pile instead of the fairy miscreant pile. Jund is better in Modern than it is in Legacy. I did have some fun with the Legacy Jund yesterday, but I think Modern Jund is like an actual top archetype, whereas Legacy Jund is just a pet deck that I'm working on. This is probably not even the right play, honestly. Now that my opponent has assembled the Thopter Sword combo, their life total seems to matter less. And maybe I should just start cracking my Nurturing Peatlands. The good news is I can threaten Liliana Ultimate next turn because I can just bolt the token that my opponent makes right now. I'm dead to a fourth land and an Urza. But the Liliana Ultimate will surely make this game interesting. Ah, they have the Urza. No fun. So now they get infinite everything, infinite mana, and they just infinite life, make infinite Thopters. See what I would have drawn if I'd cracked the Peatland. All right, nothing anyway. Leyline is okay in this matchup. I'm considering between 0 and 3 Leylines. Plague Engineer is better. All right, here's the maybe pile. I'm choosing 7 cards from among these ones up here. But we start with one of everything. And I'll go for a second ooze and a second bolt. So, Leyline shuts off their combo. Ooze does not, because I have to have more green mana than they have mana. Otherwise, every time I try to remove the sword, they can just sack something else. So, I would say the ooze does something, but it's not like one of my best cards. Engineer does stop the combo because the Thopters will come in as 0/0s and won't trigger the sword. Guess I will take away Thopter Foundry. I could take the Whir of Invention. Think I'd take Thopter Foundry. Oh, I could definitely imagine losing this game, especially if I don't hit a third land and my opponent just kind of values me with these little cantrip artifacts. Good question from Matt N. Would I rather have Grudge or Oof right now? Well, I try not to leave home without two Ancient Grudges because you want to have healthy number of answers to Ensnaring Bridge and it's just like a good card that that comes up a lot against a variety of modern decks. But if I was going to have a third anti-artifact card, that's when I would start moving to the Collector Oofs. Oh, right on time. This is an ultra combo, Seasoned Pyromancer and Leyline of the Void, because you just get to discard your bad cards. I wonder if I'm supposed to just grudge this opal. I normally hate doing stuff like that, but given that I have two grudges and my opponent's missing lands, it is a consideration. I knew it. I mean, obviously that's part of the reason why I never like to make that play, just because it's legendary artifact that they can always have more in their hand. Now I think it's probably too late to be fighting over the opal. Let's get that Teferi out of here. Guess I probably lose to the combo here. Think I lose to Urza. Thankfully, there's no Urza. I would not say Seasoned Pyromancer is a staple. I think it's a fringe card. Some people prefer Tireless Tracker. Just thinking about what happens if they get the fourth Thopter Foundry. Think I'm just gonna keep hammering. Why not discard first? Because I can empty my hand before using the Liliana. And if my opponent has Whirr for the fourth Thopter Foundry, I may even choose to use the Edict ability instead. Man, my opponent is just not going down without a fight. Alright, so my opponent is very in on Thopter combo. I'll bring in a couple more ley lines. Probably cut like the third Liliana and the second Ooze. Kind of want that Inquisition as well. I think I can do better than this. Like, I don't even have a fetch land to make use of the Wren. I am playing Fandom Legends today, yes. I'm playing with Golgari, and my first round opponent is Marcio Carvalho, playing Jeskai Planeswalkers. So the Ooze, we've had this question already, but the Ooze can technically eat the sword, but it's very difficult. Because anytime I target the sword, they can just sacrifice something new and bring back the sword. So in order to fend off their combo, I need to have more green mana than they have mana, period. Yes, they need non-token artifacts, but that's trivial for a deck with Mox Opal and Arkham's Astrolabe and everything. Posting a link in the chat for the Fandom Legends deck lists this week. All right, please no free spell. No free spells. Possible I should just fire up Ravine there. Eyeball head, thank you for the sub. Alright, so 2-1, some pretty good matches. That's gonna have to wrap up my Junding for today as we have Fandom Legends coming up. In the meantime, I want to give a shout out to my sponsor, Ultimate Guard. I'm on the Ultimate Guard Pro Team in the Pro Tour Team Series, and we're gonna be competing in the finals of the Team Series again this year. There's no the date for that event hasn't been set, but definitely keep your eye out as that's going to be a fun one to watch, taking on Haruya Sword in the finals. But anyway, yeah, thank you to Ultimate Guard for sponsoring my team and my stream channel here. I use Ultimate Guard products all the time when I play live, and the quality is always fantastic. And then Channel Fireball, of course. I mentioned the written content that you can find on the website earlier, but they also have really sweet video content. You can find both pre-recorded strategy videos and stream VODs, including mine. And you can find them either through going through the Channel Fireball main website or by following their YouTube channel.